Somebody enters into Delta City, and the first question you will ask is, where is all the oil money? Where? Some of you don't travel. Worry, Saple Road was bad. Some of you that traveled that period, it was so bad, they now started passing some villages. Over, when I saw one village, I wept in the car. You're in town. I saw a grown girl in pants. You can't see that in a city. I saw houses that were like shacks, where you will not even put an animal. People were living there. It was by the side of the road, so I could see it. Tears fell. 30 years old. 30. But go into every street, whether it's a Saba, whether it's Saple, enter anywhere. We have hundreds of denominations. But our Christianity cannot affect our territory. But things are changing. All our prayer has not been lost. The number one stool, whether they like it or not, is the number one stool in Delta State. The man with his own mouth has given the state to Jesus. With his own mouth. So some of the things that we've been doing in secret, crying concerning the territory, is not falling on deaf ears. God knows what he's doing. So tonight, first thing we need to do is, I will show you the prayer life of Jesus. And by the time we look at the prayer life of Jesus carefully, I will now show you how to establish a life of prayer. And then by that time, we'll be ready to pray. And this presence, because it's heavy now, that is hanging upon here, will now open. At that point, you will determine how far you want to travel. You will determine. And if it is that you came to this meeting, not because you saw a fine poster, not because you just came to mark time, if you came to this meeting with a hunger that my own prayer life must work, you will leave here with a quickening. All those songs we were singing just now, we're not just trying to sound nice. The fire of God will fall. Our hearts will be struck tonight. Our prayer altars will be so revived, remodeled by the fire of his presence. In the name of Jesus. Before I begin to talk about Jesus, let me show you something. Genesis chapter 4, let's go to verse 26. Genesis chapter 4, 26. I want to really give you time tonight to pray. So wherever I stop, once it is 6:15, I will stop. I want us to engage tonight for at least 20 minutes. Because some of you don't come for VG. I'm even told that some workers don't come. That the people that come, some people travel all the way. Where does that guy come from? Eh? Ugbokodo. To come and pray with us. You do not know what you've got until it's gone. I think they sang one song like that in those days. Eh? Is there not one song like that? You don't know. Genesis chapter 4 verse 26. The Bible says, and as for Seth, to him also a son was born, and he named him what? Enosh. Then men began to call on the name of the Lord. If you are familiar with scriptures, you will understand that certain events in their lives were chronicled like this. They will use an event to be able to keep in history something that will cause you to remember when that event occurred. Because we do not understand scriptures, that is why we use that portion of the Bible where it says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord. Anything stopping me from seeing the Lord, every Uzziah in my life died. No. What that writer was trying to tell you is, if you want to remember the year I saw the Lord, remember the year that what? Uzziah died. Are you here? He was not saying that Uzziah was the reason why he had not seen the Lord. He said it's in that year that Uzziah died that I saw the Lord. So that's the same thing happening here. He said the day that Seth gave birth to a son called Enosh, that season was the season when men began to do what? This is the beginning of prayer in the entire Bible. If you're a student of the scriptures, you will know that anytime the Bible uses the phrase call upon the name of the Lord, it speaks about what? Prayer. Call upon me and I will answer you, and I will show you what? Greater mighty things that thou knowest. The Bible says in Genesis 12, you get to verse 8, he says that Abraham came and he built an altar. And after he built an altar, what did he do? He began to call on the name of the Lord. He initiated prayer. Genesis chapter 13 verse 4. The Bible says he went back to the place where he had built his altar. And there he called upon the name of the Lord. So every time the Bible speaks about calling upon the name of the Lord. Romans chapter 10. I think it is verse 13 or so. It says call upon. They that call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. They that call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So every time the Bible says call upon, it's speaking about prayer. This is when prayer began. Genesis chapter 4. Because originally, when God created man, man did not need that thing called prayer. When God created man, the realm was so designed that God could come to man. That is the reason Eden existed. Eden was like an extension of the realm of God so that it became seamless for those who dwell in the realm of God to be able to enter into the realm of men. Do you know that by your prayer you can create such an environment in your house? You can create an environment that looks so much like the realm of God that angels will not know when they stumble into your environment. They will just enter and say, shoo. Oh, sorry. Because you have built a kind of atmosphere that it looks exactly like the realm where God dwells. That's how men have built their prayer place to such a way that if they as much as enter, their angelic traffic is normal. Like I can tell you when an angel has entered into a room. I can tell you. It's not every time I tell you that an angel is here that I saw one. Sometimes I just sense their presence. I can tell. So the relationship between man and God changed. Why did that relationship change? It was a consequence of the fall of Adam. So when man fell, there had to be a system by which intimacy and conversation and relationship, communion with God could be maintained. Because that atmosphere did no longer exist where God could step into the realm of man. The Bible says God came in the cool of the evening. I can imagine what Adam enjoyed. God was not hidden from Adam. Adam had such communion, such fellowship with God, that he could even tell when the footsteps of God had appeared upon his horizon. He could tell. But the corruption of sin created a vacuum such that incompatibility now existed. The divine life could no longer find compatibility with human life. And that's part of the thing that salvation does. One of the things salvation does is that it creates compatibility such that man can now find common ground with the great immortal. So, because corruption had set in, man in Genesis chapter 4 now realized that his life was vain. And the word vain there simply means empty, useless. He realized his insufficiency, that there was nothing he could do of himself. And once that realization dawned upon man, he now turned his face to the great immortal. And the Bible says men began to call upon the name of the Lord. So that was the initiation of prayer. This is why when Jesus now came in Luke 18 verse 1, he now said that the design of man is that man is a creature of prayer. Men ought always to pray and not to fall. So they ought. And if you've been here long enough, I've told you that you ought to do something does not mean you will do it. Are you here? What does it mean to ought? Give me Luke 18:1. Let's look at different translations. Luke 18:1. Let's look at different translations. Okay, this is amplified. Give me the simpler ones. NLT, Message, Bible in basic English. Aha. One day Jesus told his disciples a story to show that they should, that is ought, should. He didn't say must. Are you here? Should, you should do something, does not mean that you will do it. And the reason the scripture uses the word ought or should is that God did not create puppets. Are you following me, beloved? What I mean by God did not create puppets is this. There's a gift that God gave to man. Even Satan cannot tamper with that gift. You know what the gift is? It's the power to choose. The power to choose. I was telling them somewhere that you better don't go to hellfire. Because Satan's rot. Eh? You know when they say that they are soaking your cane in kerosene? Eh? Satan's rot is waiting for all those people who lied against him. When they lied against the Holy Ghost killed people. But you see, the power and life of life and death has not been given to Satan. He can't kill you. It's not given to him. So he's waiting. Because Satan cannot make you do anything you don't want to do. Satan is not that powerful. He doesn't have power. He doesn't have authority over your will. No. So why are you watching pornography? Satan. Satan is, he soaked your cane deeper in the kerosene. Woe betide you that you arrive in hell because you're back. He cannot make you do anything you don't want. The same way God cannot make you do anything you don't want to. So he said, men ought. So a time will come in your life that you will choose your ought. You, by an act of your will now say, I'm supposed to be praying, no? I should be praying, no? You will now submit yourself to that design. The other thing you need to see there is that it is for men, not for spirits. So it means if you have not chosen that ought, you are not a man. You might dress like you are a human being, talk like a human being, but in the realm of immortals, they don't see you as a man. Because one of the signs that you are a human being, you are a man, you are mortal, is that you submit to that technology of prayer. Last thing is, the opposite of prayer, a prayerful person is not prayerlessness. If you are not praying, the Bible says that you will be what? Fainting. So many people are in church and their shape in the spirit is that they are fainted. Fainted men. Those are the kind of people that Satan uses their skull to play Ludo. Their throat is how they used to train witches. When a new witch joins the clan, they now say, okay, we'll send you for IT. Their throat is the landing pad for IT for new witches. Every day they are pressing your throat, bro. When will you get up? You are fainting. Young witches that have not even learned anything, they are using your life to do practice. So when you get there, wind the ear, wind the, then their master stands near your bed. You say, wind the ear. The wind your ear. Hey! So you press the throat, press the throat. The press the throat, you do like, you want to shout Jesus, you can't even shout. Yeah. You see how you are pressing it. Next time, put your finger here. If you press here, you will die. The problem is that you are fainting. There is a way that you will create an atmosphere around your life. A witch knows that it's a death sentence to enter your room. A death sentence. And you see, I can teach you these things because I have walked this road. The way it used to happen to me is that as I'm lying on the bed, the first thing I will sense is a presence in my room. You know, I listen to some clowns and let me leave them. Nobody can tell me that thing is not real. That is a figment of my imagination. No. There were times that I will literally see my room door open like this. And then in my heart I'll say, again, what have I done to deserve this kind of suffering? I used to prepare myself for it. As I'm sleeping, I know that when it gets to 12 a.m., 1 a.m., I'm preparing for an encounter. You know how people come for meeting, they say, I will meet Jesus. I used to prepare as I go to bed that my throat will be somebody's apprenticeship. I used to prepare for it. And then a shadow, I'm not telling you fables. I will literally see a shadow enter my room. And then the next thing, I can't breathe. But one day I became angry. Can I have tongues on my lips and then anything will just enter my room? Some of you are mothers over children. Satan can just come and give your child chicken pox. When he finishes with that one, he gives the next one fever. Finishes with that one, and you are there just saying, Lord, help you. The technology is that you submit yourself to become a creature of prayer. To guard your territory.